This meeting is being recorded.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, folks. Michael Zuber, one rental at a time, back with his friend Taylor from Life Goal Investments. How you doing, buddy?
Doing great. Let's do this. I'm excited.
Yeah, so we're going to talk about, we're going to ask you to kind of be the little guy, right? You're a 10-year Wall Street veteran. You're making big moves all the time. I'm going to ask you to be just that mom and pop investor for a moment.
Yeah.
And, you know, let's be also very clear. I think the winning investment thus far in the year has been cash, right? Cash is not trash. Cash is an opportunity on the future. Bonds are down. Stocks are down. Crypto's down. It's not been a good year. Cash has been the right place to be.
Yep.
So I want to talk to you about, given all the volatility, does that continue to be the place to be? Or when does the mom and pop investor stick their toe in the water? When do they create a shopping list? When do they go, peak fear is in, let's nibble? Think about all of that, because it's crazy times.
Yeah, I think it's right now, honestly. I think that there is peak bearishness, there's so much bad out there right now, regardless of the direction you look at it. And rightfully so, because you have a US dollar that is rallying, which is really hard on domestic companies. We've discussed this in the past, but for every percentage increase in the dollar against global currencies, which we've seen 18% increase this year, 18, that's a half a point reduction in S&P 500 earnings. So that right there accounts for a 9% drop in earnings, is historically the way that's played out. So you have that going on. You have, just slowing demand across the board for a plethora of different reasons. But that's kind of priced into the market. The market is saying we're going into recession. We talked about this on video one, where the yield curve right now is coming crashing down after it went spiraling up, and it's all over the place. But I think that's saying the market is interpreting as yields are coming down because we think that we're going to go into a recession. And you say, okay, Taylor, you said just start dipping your toe. Like, now you're telling us we're going into a recession. But what you actually see is that, one, you can't time the bottom in anything. You can't time the bottom in the economy. You can't time the bottom in the stock market. You can't time the bottom in the bond market. So what we think is that although we don't think we've seen a bottom in the stock market, we do think that we've likely seen, if not all of the bottom of the bond market, darn near it. And we think that the stock market will likely bottom in the next 6-month-ish timeframe. So if you've got $1,000 using round numbers right now, chunk it out, break it into 5 pieces, whatever it is, and put 1/5 of that to work on the first Tuesday of every single month over the next 5 months. You're not going to catch the absolute bottom, but as this thing chops along like this, hopefully you're averaging down, and then we start to get that base and start to come out of the other side. It's not rocket science, this theory, but we have been saying all year, for the record, we don't like the market. And we don't love the market right now, but we like it a heck of a lot better than when everybody wanted everything to do with the market at the end of 2021, which is when we were saying, pump the brakes. Now we're saying the brakes are fully pumped, and it might be time to start to say, okay, how much worse can this get? It can get worse. Don't get us wrong. But I think that if you start to enter the market now, 3 years from now, you're a happy camper.
Yeah. Let me push back on that idea again. And I do this just because I can. Disagree with me all you want.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think one of the things that's still in front of us, at least for this month, I think we're still set up for more bad news than good news on the short term, meaning this month, October. Right. I think we're going to have an earnings recession. I think even all the rosy, stupid ass Wall Street expectations for earnings are going to get cut in the next 30 days. I think we've seen multiple compression. I think now we have earnings cuts. So again, if I was sitting in cash, which I am, and I have money allocated for stocks for the first time in 20 years, I look at this going, earnings are still coming, and I think they're going to generally be negative. Maybe I start this 1/5. I love that 1/5. I love the pick a date, be religious about it. But maybe there's enough reason to go, you know what? Let's wait a couple of weeks. We got a CPI print in 2 weeks, which may be worse than expected. You know, we have a jobs number this Friday, which I think will be good news is bad news, which will be strong. I mean, there's enough stuff in the next 3 calendar weeks, right? We have Apple and Tesla reporting, which I don't think are going to be great, which are the last 2 stalwarts. I look at this going as an individual guy who's got money set aside for stocks going, I don't know, maybe I wait 3 more weeks. I don't know. What do you think of all that?
Yeah. I just think that in that 3-week period of time, what you could potentially see is that 10% gap up off the bottom. And I don't actually think it takes place. So don't say, you know, don't let me allude to the fact that you're going to see a 10% bounce. I don't think that's going to take place. But the bounce off the bottom is meaningful. And I don't
think the bounce will be violent. I think the bounce will be violent.
Yeah, exactly. And whether it's the Fed, you know, alluding to the fact that they're going to pivot, which we've got some time before that can happen, but inflation data will come out and tell us that that's going to take place when it does.
I don't think it's going to be this time, but we'll talk about that next week.
Yeah. No, that's perfectly fine. I think that, again, if that's your thesis, then maybe what you do is you extend it further out and say, okay, you know, just back your dates up a month. Or if you,
it's kind of where I'm sitting.
I like this approach better. Cause I do want people to start getting involved in the market right now, because I think it is behoove of that, but you just add an extra month to it, break it into six pieces, break it into there seven pieces, and push it back further. Again, what you're doing is just de-risking there. The further out you go, the lower level of risk you're taking, because obviously you're not having as much money in the market as early on.
Yeah, and then total fairness, I actually bought JP Morgan Friday, the last minute of the close. So I picked it up for 104.40 because it had a 4% yield. I'm like, well, I already got, you know, the 10-year or the 2-year treasury or whatever it was over 4. I can get JP Morgan with a 4. So I bought probably 1/5, maybe 1/4 of what I'll eventually buy. But again,
you're in the market.
I actually bought a stock. I love it.
And you know what else I like? Because we preach this all day. What do you have there? You have a stock and a bond. You've got diversification there in two holdings. Now, granted, that's not necessarily how I would have told you to do it had you asked me what you did. Yeah. But
I didn't.
What you have there is diversification, right? Yeah. And that's incredibly important, because obviously, you know, you could see, you know, JP Morgan gap down. I don't think it's likely. I think they're pretty well bruised up at this point, but you could see that gap down 10% without it being crazy.
I have my next tranche at 99 or 99.05 or something. Again, I don't know if it'll go there, but I got a bid in case it does.
But what the listeners are hearing right now is a discipline. So it's a discipline. And you said, and it is important to have those very specific dates. Those very specific dates are important, because if you do see more downside after you put in the first tranche and your next tranche comes, it's going to be because there's bad shit going on. It's going to be because bad things are happening in the news. And what are you going to not want to do? You're not going to want to invest it. That's why you need to stick to the game plan, create it, stick to it. And you know, I hate to say it, but like, your sentiment generally as an investor is not the right sentiment. The best times to invest are when it feels the worst. The worst times to invest were December of last year, when everybody wanted everything to do with everyone. They were talking to their friends about how they were making so much money and XYZ. You all know the stories, but that is when it feels good. That is when it feels good. That's not the best time to invest. Warren Buffett, obviously, when there's blood in the streets, yada, yada. There's blood in the streets right now. Could there be more? No doubt.
Yeah. And the reason I actually bought a stock was because more and more, I haven't seen bearishness like this since the .com crash. Everybody I talk to is negative. Everybody's scared. I'm like, well, I got this little pile of cash over here. I got my shopping list. Let's go find the one that I want to start with and, you know, pull the trigger.
To be very clear, generally there, well, I don't want to say this. To be very clear, you do not need some magnificent reason for the stock market to bottom and take off. There does not need to be some silver bullet where this plays out.
Nobody's going to ring a bell.
Yep. Things can, but it doesn't necessarily, you don't need to get some wild inflation print that comes down significantly. That it can just be that things do get oversold. And with the algorithmic driven system that we have these days, what happens is we get a little bit of positivity in the market. Then all of a sudden these computer systems start to drive it up further and further. And it can become a little bit of a self-fulfilling prophecy. Now that's overdoing it a little bit, but nonetheless, what I'm getting at is when you look back to 2008, there wasn't one single event that caused the market to crash. It was a combination of different ones.
That's and by then a in thousand March of 09, cuts.
Yeah. When March of 09 on the other side, when it actually did bottom, there was no huge event that happened in March of 09 to have things rally off the other end.
Yeah. Taylor, where can people find you? Cause you put out amazing stuff that really is provocative, makes people think. I appreciate what you put out.
Thanks for saying that. Yeah. So find us at Life Goal Investments on Instagram, @LifeGoalInvestments.
Thanks, buddy.